Hi, and welcome to No Borders Radio, and this is a public law with Bo and Tami. We're also simulcasting on Tyrannosaur tonight. You can find that at TIRNASAOR.com, and No Borders, of course, can be found at NoBordersRadio.co.uk. How are you, Bo?
I'm okay, I'm fine.
So,
like my rough voice better.
Yeah, the Alex Jones.
Maybe people listen to me if I talk like this.
Or if you threw fits like Alex Jones. How about you just call people trash. Call them trash. Oh, I love that guy. Who does that on YouTube? He's got a whole channel dedicated
to... Yeah, Trash TV. I don't know. He's just some video maker who makes all the videos out of InfoWars TV shows.
It's interesting. So starting out, we had some questions today from some of our students, and they say, well, what's the best thing that we can do? What can we do to help? You know, we talked some about law enforcement, and, you know, of course, always the foundational docs, which are the forgiveness and the executor docs. In a soundbite, what would you say to the listeners on just the foundation itself?
Well, I spelled it all out in that zip file up there. It's called Basics of the Public Law, and it can be found in that authorized document section that takes you to the Dropbox. And for those that want to know the startup process in detail, I wrote it out pretty well, I thought, and you thought it was pretty good also. So, basically it's just a matter of you have to make your intentions known, and that involves recording a couple of documents, one pagers, absolute forgiveness, and the appointment to the executor for your estate. So those and your fee schedule kind of gets you on your way, and then you want to get the ordinance of estates done. That's going to be your main document that is going to be what your foundation is based on. It's all laid out on the ordinance of estates.
And it includes your other house members as well.
Right.
So, any children, any house members, I mean, it can be anybody. And we've also been, the last month or so, playing with the government function. And you can elect a governor to govern your house when you're not able. We have put that into play. And again, know yourself first. First, you want to build your house on stone. And that is the foundational docs. That means that you are the government. If you elect a governor, and that's what we've been doing with several other houses, there's a lot of fourth generation warfare applied from various directions at all times, coming from the United States Incorporated. And there are those of us, such as myself, that have been through all of these things. And that has been my learning process. And, you sure can elect me, for example, as your governor of your house, under your house, not over your house. And I cannot be your governor. You cannot elect me as your governor without having your house established, because I don't want your authority. As your governor, you authorize me to do whatever you need to have done, or to do whatever you need me to do. And that allows you still to maintain your sovereignty. And that's a requirement. Jesus said, know thyself. He didn't say, hey, go pick yourself somebody to represent you. And he said it over and over and over again. Pick up your cross and follow me. He never said, let go of your authority. He never said, and he specifically was so adamant against it, that you allow somebody to represent you in any way. Call no man your father, not even Christ. In Matthew 23, 1 Corinthians 6, don't put yourself in another jurisdiction. Maintain your authority.
Yeah, the basic soundbite of the whole thing is you're removing yourself as corporate stock that is being administered by Congress. Your House of Representatives are representing you. Well, this stops that process and divests title, as we say, and revests into your own house, to which that is the thing you patronize from now on, no longer patronizing your oppressor. And your fee schedule is your constitution. That's what says that, okay, if you want to do business with me, then here's the constitution. Might want to read my constitution, because I just made you aware of it, so it still applies whether you read it or not. So, of course, those idiot attorneys didn't want to argue that in my case, so, you know, just so sad for them.
Right, and that was their failure, and that's, you know, that's what it says exactly, word by word, line by line in Revelation. It says that the delegate is going to take down the dragon itself. It is the delegate that does that because they feel like they're unstoppable. They feel immortal. They've been let loose on humanity and held up high on these pedestals, and they fell a long way on their way down. And of course, the laws of gravity kick in at that point. When something's put up so high, it just has a harder fall.
Yeah, you got to be prepared. I will tell you this. Expect for them to just roll over your paperwork and argue statute, seeming like they're not paying any attention. It makes no difference as long as you get it on the record and you hold your ground.
Right. You have to evidence that you're believing. If there's no contrast, if there's no test, then what is there? You know, your whole point in divesting yourself of all that possesses you, taking away the power that you vested into Congress and taking up your own authority, is that test. And you can't just say, I am, I am, I am, I am. You actually have to be. And in that, you are known by your works and actions. You're going to hold them accountable. You are the authority. You're going to be the authority. And in this process, you learn how to take your house and be that house. And this is what we're here for. The public law is your law. This is your word that I've been speaking this whole time. You all out there, human beings, that are, I'm not speaking to the attorneys, of course, and the agents and psychopaths. You won't hear me anyway because you're financially motivated. But for the human being, your authority is of utmost importance. Your family is of utmost importance. The children are the utmost importance. And taking back your authority and governing yourself is not, you know, being lawless, being, you know, in chaos. You have law. You have the public law. Do no harm. And that means accountability. And that's the first thought in the human being. We don't do things that harm other human beings or harm other entities or harm other beings with intentions, because that's not within our biological makeup in the first place. The psychopath does those things, and they can count human beings as objects or things. And that's the difference between us and them, but absolutely not in a lawless manner. Never, ever. Human beings have never been lawless. They don't have the ability of, you know, contemplating just absolute chaos. There's always that binding there, and that is, of course, the truth itself, or relativity.
Okay.
Well, we can get into some headlines, too. I wasn't able to get to on Thursday. The VA stuff, you know, they've got so much going on. They're perpetrating genocide against our brothers and sisters, the veterans out there that have served their various countries and fought in so many wars on behalf of other various patriarchs. And now they're feeling the brunt of the action of genocide. You know, this is horrifying. You know, there's directives there now that are saying, no, this is such and such veteran, this veteran with this amount of money or this veteran with that amount of money, we're not going to take care of them. We're just going to let them die. And I watched that with my, you know, my own biological father. And, you know, after a few heart attacks, the VA said, well, your insurance doesn't cover that. And then the last time, they turned him away and said, no, you're not having a heart attack. Well, he ended up going to a private hospital immediately, right after this was spoken. And he got to the private hospital in Richland, Washington. And they said that he was involved in having a heart attack at that time. So the VA had determined that he was no longer a viable product, and he had expended all of his veterans insurance. And at that point in time, going to the private pay, of course, his VA pension and VA insurance didn't cover that. So then it started redistributing his assets, his known assets. So it's all in the business schematic. It's the same business schematic across the board. It doesn't matter if you're a veteran, if you're a female, if you're a nurse, if you're a doctor, if you're on GEICO insurance, if you're on veterans insurance. When your insurance is expended and when it runs out, you're done. You're done. And if you don't have other assets for the system to redistribute, then that's when you go into and you find yourself in debt.
But Tammy, those GEICO commercials are so cute. I want to get insurance.
Yeah, that's just
even though I don't have insurance now.
Yeah, it's just sick. Government. A Government Employees Insurance Corporation. Look that up, because that's what GEICO means. It means Government Employees Insurance Company. And of course, it's owned mainly by none other than Buffett himself. You know, that's Berkshire Hathaway. And you need to look into these things and find out who owns you and why you find yourself so ill, so sick, so... or such a good product, or debt derivative at the end. You know, if your insurance runs out, there's always that final option and opportunity for the government, the state, United States Incorporated, in collecting on those debt derivatives, cashing in on your death at the very end.
So I should probably just buy the lizard instead of getting the insurance.
Absolutely, it's cheaper. Just get a GEICO. That's just foul, you know, and we've covered that on several shows on, you know, who Buffett is or what Buffett is. And again, New York today.
You know, we have one more point on that insurance is they sure hammer that stuff home, like on Fox News, you know, listening to Sean Hannity's show and all these other shows and pop-ups on the internet sites. They just hammer you with insurance. Don't they? I mean, it's just, you know, everywhere.
Right, and that's one of the most prolific trick and deceptions is that, you know, that word insurance, you become the surety, you become the assurance something's going to happen to you. If you have, you know, $200,000 of life insurance, you can bet that there's $1 million somewhere else where your beneficiaries might get $200,000, but the state beneficiary is going to get a lot more out of that. And liability insurance, home insurance, flood insurance, fire insurance. And we've been showing this all year long through the guarantee insurance documentary that we did in parts. And finally, we put it all together to show everybody actually what occurs. Here's the agents on the ground. They're burning your houses down. Here's an agent on the ground flooding you out. Here's an agent on the ground, a principal agent. I mean, part of that documentary was the principal agent at a school burning down a school. Because you can only industrialize or build a community if you raise it to the ground first. So there first has to be a need to, quote, rebuild, and then you can rebuild. And that's why you're seeing all of this destruction right now, because they're not, they lost all their funding. They're garnering private funding through developers now rather than development grants. And that's a major part of, again, you go back to Revelation, it says these things, and that's what you're seeing. From Reuters.com today, New York's pension plan smoothing may shortchange retirement fund. You know, these are all over, folks. They're taking your retirement, and they're taking it with a really smooth tongue, telling you that they're doing this and this, and, aw, shucks, we had to do something to fix something somewhere else. And it's all the same game, all the same schematic. This means they're going to keep your money because they don't have anything else. And again, it's not a good idea to patronize this thing or to plan for, quote, retirement, knowing that they're going to raise it before you get there. That's the whole point of shutting up the kingdom and using legal process, is taking that inheritance before the heirs can get at it, and that includes your retirements.
Yeah, it's pretty disgusting once you know these things about how the schematic works, isn't it?
Absolutely, and this is, you know, it's portrayed over and over again. Rome, Greece, you can watch that. It's a very, very sick and disgusting movie to watch. But Caligula actually shows what Caesar does, how he accomplishes what he needs to do and have done, what they do to maintain a populace under control. You can read Cooper's Behold a Pale Horse, or he's got a lecture out, and you can see that on YouTube, Behold a Pale Horse. And I'll warn you up front that it is very dry to listen to and very dry to read. But it's one of the most important reads, or if you listen to the lecture, you'll ever come across. You know, he explains it as to the action of energy induction. He explains all of these things as you go along. And gives you a better idea of what's going on and why you're being targeted and how you're used as to a human resource.
They're going to resource you, are they?
Yeah, it's just sad. You know what? I mean, in the beginning, I was disheartened as well. So don't go away. Don't go away. You can take breaks. You know, don't take on more than you can chew. But realize that we've all been there. Was there, I was there. You know, it's very, very disheartening when you first realize what's going on, and all the things that you've ever patronized are killing you or using you in some way. But Jeff used to tell me, I used to whine, and Jeff would say, get over yourself, Tammy. You know, no whining, no crying, come on, get over yourself, let's move forward. And it took a lot of that.
Yeah, it is interesting to see some of the students coming along and now actually going through with the process finally after all this time. We had some in the beginning there that said they were doing the process, and of course they turned out to be FBI agents.
Right, right. And that was something very profound to see, because, you know, it was constant for the longest time. And I was laughing today about having time this week. I found time this week to do just the simplest things and enjoy a few things, and it surprised me after that, because I realized that I'd had time to do other things outside of this.
Yeah, I will say this though, if you're going to fight your court case with the public law, don't mess around. Get your foundational documents recorded and get us a copy, so we can get it to our law enforcement.
Right, immediately. Because the liens are being laid down as we speak, you want to get your F&E docs to us, your fee schedule, and your ordinance of the estate, so we know that, you know, what children are in your estate, how much to bill them, whatever else, as well as when you first served them. You have to notify them of your fee schedule. You have to notify them of your ordinance of the estates and where your F&E docs are located. The moment they are notified and they have notice of these things, that's when the fee schedule starts. If they want to contract with you, they'll send you a summon. If they want to contract with you, they'll attempt to serve you with whatever. Make sure that you have all of that evidence and you get them to this court so that we can hold them accountable. And it's very swift now. We're moving very, very swiftly. First liens went down. I mean, it's been exploding on, you know, what's going on now. And it's a lot smoother now than it was before. And Bo is talking about, you know, how they harass and everything. Well, it's not economically feasible for them to harass you anymore now that they've experienced what the fee schedule does, now that they've experienced the first liens, now that they've, you know, they wasted a lot of our time. We had to go through their insurance, yada, 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 and do all of these things. Insurance turned down. They said, well, we don't cover acts of war. We don't cover civil war risks. And that's what allowed us to, they're opened up for foreclosure now because their insurance doesn't cover any of these actions. And so, you know, get your docs done, get your house in order. And again, Jesus said to build a house on stone, you need to get that in order and make sure that your house is standing before you do anything else.
Yeah, and if you're, especially if you're facing jail time, as long as this is not jail time regarding harm on a human being, if it's some kind of the same old financial crimes or any kind of crimes that are just under 27 CFR 72.11, where it says all crimes are commercial, you need to do this before they lock you up, because once they lock you up, you're stuck. You might as well just bail out or whatever you got to do, serve your time.
Right, unless you've, you know, like Rocco, he was taken because they were trying to hardball us into shutting up and backing down, and of course we couldn't. We cannot contract with other states, and at the end, what happens? Well, they lose, and they get foreclosed upon. It's still the same action that occurs, and it just, they were trying to whine, and they were trying to wiggle out of it, and threaten to harass and terrorize us, and it doesn't work. We can't contract regardless, and you know, don't wait until the last minute and then contact me and say, Tammy, I've got a hearing tomorrow, because I can't deal with that. I'm not going to deal with that. You have notice. Usually you get notice like 3 months ahead of time. Let me know 3 months ahead of time. Don't tell me the day before your hearing. You know, don't throw other stuff at the wall and see what sticks. And if nothing works, then fall back on me, because at that point in time, usually I don't have any time. You know, don't short-sight anything. And we're back, and you are listening to The Public Law right here on No Borders Radio at noborders.co.uk, and also we're simulcasting on Tiranisseur, and you can find that at tiranisseur.com as well. Hopefully we can be heard this time. From whtc.com, former Wellspring church pastor charged with embezzlement. This one was interesting because I actually commented on this mainstream media piece today, and they left my comment on there, which is not, prior to now, was not normal occurrence, as it was usually taken right back off. The body of it says a local pastor was in Hudsonville District Court Thursday afternoon facing charges of embezzlement, where he was a pastor at Wellspring Church on Bower Road. He resigned last September. During the probable cause hearing on Thursday, the church's finance committee chairman testified that there were more than $18,000 in questionable expenses on an American Express card that had the church's name on it, but was controlled by Peterson. Peterson is currently pastor at the Rock Church in Granville. So he's charged for embezzlement at one church, and he's currently working at another. So make sure all of the constituents and followers are well aware of what's going on here, because you're about to be sucked dry too. That's their function.
Oh, I'm sure somebody's keeping tabs on him now. He's got that surety mark on him.
Hopefully he's got an ankle bracelet on while he's up there preaching the word of the Lord God.
Yeah, so we need to see more priests and pastors with ankle bracelets, I think.
Absolutely. That one, I thought you could cover the law school one, because you're the one that sent it to me, and I thought it was so funny.
Well, I just kind of skimmed through it, and they're saying that the enrollment's down. This comes out of the New York Times, and of course it is.
Law school,
yeah. Law school, it's like, who wants to go to school, spend all that time and money learning this law stuff, basically.
Learning how to be Satan.
Yeah. Yeah, learning how to deal in hypothecating human beings and perpetuating genocide, and then on top of all, you got to pay a bunch of money for it, and so you can have all these student loans to pay back, and how are you going to do that if they're cutting back on the attorneys, because that's just part of the schematic. I mean, the attorney's got to, you know, go the way of the dinosaur.
Absolutely, and this is beautiful to see. I'm glad to see that you know, children are thinking twice about going into such a profession, and of course, attorneys that have been in the system forever. In January, you know, it was ordered that they get, and for their continuing education, they have mandatory psych evals, and that turned away a lot of senior attorneys as well, which we've been seeing in recent months. You know, one of them, they were coercing her because she refused to re-up her license, and they were really sticking it to her, telling her, no, you're going to be the surety. And she says, no, I don't want to be the surety. But ultimately, she was forced back into it and forced under the thumb, of course. And that's what it's all about. You want to play the game, you get to pay the price.
Says as of this month, there were 30,000 applications to law schools for the fall, a 20% decrease from the same time last year, and a 38% decline from 2010. According to the Law School Admissions Council, of some 200 law schools nationwide, only four have seen increases in applications this year. In 2004, there were 100,000 applicants to law schools. This year, there are likely to be 54,000. By the fall, we'll likely see that decline more.
Good.
I mean, well, that's not what it said. I'm speculating that that's my little bit at the end.
Well, good.
But probably by the fall, those numbers will even be down more.
Right. I'd rather see them get out now before they actually, you know, put their hand in genocide and in human trafficking than, you know, go that far, because, again, you're being held accountable for your words. So it's better if you go work at Walmart than, you know, working as an attorney. You come out better in the end.
This is like, that's like boot camp for their army for the war against humanity. So, yeah, of course we want to see those numbers drop.
Absolutely.
But then we need some there to get thrown into the chute to offset congressional bankruptcy, too.
Absolutely.
So.
General.
Eventually, I just want to see it when they get their diploma, you know, their bar, they pass the bar, and then they get taken right into custody.
Yeah, North Korea, here we come. It's interesting.
I mean, they are just criminals.
Absolutely. Yucky.
You know, they run everything in the government, what's called the government, whether it be United States government or Scottish land, you know, Scotland, and Australia, under the 1941 Atlantic Charter. Once again, folks, the U.S. Congress got world dominion. So, what you think is a separate country is only just basically ear salad that your speechifiers in chief and the talking heads on the media are telling you that it is. Because these treaty agreements are really what the world runs on, and the treaties are all banking agreements. to offset congressional bankruptcy. So all roads lead to Rome.
Absolutely, and if you want a closer look into that, the Treaty of Westphalia, you should start there. It says everything. The empire is America, is France, is Germany, is Rome. They're all entered into treaty agreements with each other to use human beings as a method of production.
Yeah, now when you see, like, in this headline that I was reading yesterday, where France is turning its nose to the United States Inc., and they are supplying Russia with two warships, it's all part of a act, a play. It's a play act that...
Hegelian dialectic.
Yeah, it's an utter facade to throw before the sheeple and, you know, create this reality for them that's not, it's just not true once you read the treaties.
Right. And especially their own hand when it comes to what the CIA is, foreign and military intelligence. And the most profound reading is, of course, Book 4 of the Church Committee Reports, Supplementary Detailed Staff Reports on Foreign and Military Intelligence. And that one just, it'll really open your eyes. If you can get through it, read it. If you don't want to read it, I read it for you. It's on our YouTubes. And, you know, it says it all. It says, look, the CIA is promoting civil war in all of these countries. Vietnam was the CIA production. Japan, CIA production. Russia, the Cold War, CIA production. Syria is a CIA production. The Bundy Ranch is a CIA production. All of these things are promoted to engineer civil war and pit you against your brothers and sisters. So then Congress doesn't have to worry about taking you guys out. You take each other out. The minute you see another color or another race, another religion, another culture, you take each other out. That's the promotion of civil war. That is how it occurs. That is how they then offer you a constitution and say, I'll save you, I'll be your daddy. And you can read that in the post-conflict constitutional drafter's handbook.
Ooh, that's a good one to understand. Yeah, I forgot about that. I could have used that on my show Wednesday, where I tore them a new one, basically, right. Otherwise.
Absolutely, and it's right in the title. Post-conflict constitutional drafter's handbook. First they promote the Civil War, first they cause the Civil War, then they offer the Constitution, and then that's when you're sucked into the game and when you start patronizing the same thing that just killed your brothers and sisters. Bottom line, it's business.
I did point out how Russia's got their own constitution, just like every other
Iraq
these.
Does too. Iran, Israel, Afghanistan. They also all have an international bar association that's maintained by the House of Delegates.
It's the same structure everywhere.
Absolutely.
I mean, all the alternative media stations that are saying the new world is coming and the sky is falling, the Chicken Little syndrome. This stuff, I mean, that's way old news. 1941, Atlantic Charter.
Yep.
Hello.
Yep. It was all in the bag.
And people keep voting for this form of government until they got your consent. You know, they gave you disclosure. They told you everything in these charters. Well, they're not going to teach them to you in school. I mean, you people need to educate your kids at home and get them to read these things, you know? I mean, that's the whole point of, you know, our war is that they can propagandize us, lie to us. And, you know, but they do have to give us disclosure. And that is in the actual treaties and such. So.
And the charters and all of their congressional actions. Those are all evidence of their wars against humanity. And the other night I was so sad to announce the death of R.G. Rummel. You can go to his site at Power Kills. It's at hawaii.edu, Power Kills. And that says it all. It says... You know, it talks about democracy as a method of depopulation. Demo means people. Kratos means to control or possess. A democratic society is just the control and possession of people. Polykratos means to control and possess. Many politics stems from those two words, polykratos. And that's what it's all about. And
well, once you realize this system, why would you want to stay in the system?
Right. Right. And that's what Jesus said. Know thyself and basically use your own discretion. It's all written. And again, it's a game. It's principal agent games. Do you want to be the author, or do you want to be a pawn on that chessboard? You know, it's not just chess. It's also the game of risk, which is insurance. You know, you've got attorneys out there betting against you, betting on you, and then hedging the bet, which you know as municipal hedge funds. So in order to insure those bets, they've got agents on the ground, foot soldiers, that make things happen to you based on simple predetermined sets, character sets. And you've taught about that many, many times with the silent weapons and for quiet wars. And anybody can find that on Bono's Entertainment on his YouTube channel and go through the descriptive introduction of the silent weapon. And that's one of the most profound aspects of this silent weapon is, you know, everybody's worried about the NSA being spied on, whatever else, but they're taking SAT tests. You're taking evaluations at your workplace. You're registering for licenses. You're filling out census forms and Delphi surveys. You're giving over that information. And in that information goes into the cloud. And what the silent weapon is that you're already a predetermined character. And they know what pressure to put against you to make you move in a certain direction, which is chess, the game of chess. Once you divest yourself of all that possesses you, as you just said, drop all those titles, drop all those names, stop buying into all this stuff, you're no longer predictable. And the game can no longer be played against you. Because once you're unpredictable, you're no longer a piece on that chessboard. You're above that chessboard. Once you realize what they are and how they move and what makes them tick, then you can play the game of chess. And that's what Roman law is. It's winner take all. It's the separation between, are you the chess player or are you a piece on that board?
Well, for all the old Star Trek fans out there, there's a original series episode called The Gangsters of Triskelion. And that sort of gives you a scenario of what's going on. They pit these people to do battle against each other, and they bet on it.
Right. And it's, what was that movie that was out this year and a couple years ago? The Hunger Games. Same thing. And tons of them. There was 1 year ago, Ice-T was in, called Surviving the Game. Same thing. Politicians are hunting homeless people. Politicians are betting on your survival. What you'll do against each other in order to survive if you're pit up against each other. Again, divest yourself of all that possesses you. Don't be separate from your brothers and sisters in the first place. Don't take up the concept of culture. Don't take up the concept of a homeland or a country that you're patronizing. Don't take up the concept of a football team to patronize over your fellow human being. You know. Kitty's upset with me talking and not paying attention to the sovereign cat. He's going to yell. You know, these things are, it's very simple once you realize what the game is to back out of the game and not be that pawn. And it's very important that you're not a player on that chessboard, that nobody else is playing you. As Jesus said, you're the author of your own book. And the book of life is simply in being. When you're taking up other titles, such as man, woman, or subscribing as an individual or somebody with constitutional makeup, which is again, that possesses you. Possession is 9/10 of the law. So if you're possessed by Congress's Constitution, you're their property. And it's the same thing if you're getting a marriage license. You know, that marriage license is the sickest thing I've ever seen, because the male is actually renting the female from the state, although the state has been claiming that the male is sexist and the male is chauvinistic.
They're promoting the same thing in the gay community now, and
absolutely
starting to build consensus reality, get these gay people legally married.
Right, to rent each other from the state. And then the state comes in and it points the finger at everybody and says, no, it's your fault. We're the good guy. When they're selling you and renting you to each other.
Yeah, getting that marriage license is like saying that, yes, we acknowledge your authority to allow us to get married, and so we're going to enter into contract with the state, and so when if we get divorced, you know, we'll allow you to basically
cash in on everything.
Cash in.
Yeah, we'll let you offer me an agent that'll take her off of me or take him off of me. And we've all experienced these things. How did you end up in divorce? Well, my wife ran off. My husband ran off. With who? Well, I don't know. They're just shaking their tail, yada, yada, yada. Most often they're in uniform. Most often they work on state employee. Or they have some other financial benefit. Well, why is that? Well, they're agents. That's their function. That's what they do. They divide families. Divide and conquer. And that's all it takes to redistribute the wealth and assets of whole entire communities, is simply by division. Division, division, division. You're black, you're white, you're Christian, you're Muslim, you're Jew, you're Catholic. You're special. He's not. Yeah, you know, all of these things. It's over and over again, the 8 stages of genocide being played out at all times, in all instances, fourth generation warfare, and all of these financial forces upon you, separating you. And then you're taught how to speak, how to act, how to think, what to have, what you should be, what you could be, what you ought to be. And all of these things are working on you at all times to divide you and part you from the original garment. And that's what allows Jesus to be crucified, casting lots.
So, yeah, it's really a no-brainer once you understand the system. Unless you like that, unless you like being administered and human trafficked and genocided and having your families broken, and like living with Leslie, attorneys can have more. Well, then by all means, go get those certificates and registrations, people.
Absolutely. Ask the daddy to rent you to each other. And that's exactly what you're doing when you're getting a license to get married, especially the male. When you have to ask the state for her hand, you're actually taking over that ward on behalf of the Lord God there for a short amount of time. You're only renting her. And after that, if something happens to her, the male is given what is known as a courtesy hold over the estate. So that courtesy is only there as long as they have issue born of the marriage, which issue means children under the law. And you're just holding on to that estate until the children become of age. Well, what is the state doing all that time? They're dividing you. They're charging the children with crime. They're charging the male with crimes. So all in all, that estate is always stolen off of you, the female, and the child prior to the time that the heir can come in and claim that estate. And that's the whole concept and the underlying facilitation of this business model.
Yeah, or like Gene Keating likes to say, the hair. Spelled H-E-I-R. He always pronounces it hair. I don't know.
That's funny. I didn't listen to him.
I don't listen to Gene Keating for the UCC information anymore. I just listen to for the comedic value. And he's a funny guy.
It sounds like it. Hair. Is it as bad as Ron Klass and his spowing? Sorry, well, I had to. It's so profound to see all of these different gurus and special people, S-P-E-S-H-U-L.
Yeah, well, what's not funny is that they're all leading you back to Rome through that, you know, garnering your consent that Constitution has the almighty authority. Even the people that are asking about how, you know, do you have any evidence that this law or that this Constitution applies to me? When you have to go ask that question, of course those corporate counsel attorneys don't have to answer that. You're there asking, so you've already acknowledged your consent. So
right, and then they have authority over you, that they're your father because you're there asking them. And I was talking to somebody yesterday about that, and it doesn't even enter into their thoughts. They're like, no, I went into court and yada yada yada, and you know, they don't like it when it doesn't work out. Well, you're an infant while you're in there. You're patronizing, calling that thing your father. Jesus said, don't do that in 1 Corinthians 6. And under the nullification proclamation of Andrew Jackson, he said, you know, it's contempt of court to argue statute or legislation. So the whole time you're in there, they're putting on a show, but you're being held in contempt for 6, 7, 10 years. And at the end, you know, they might dismiss the case, but that's because you paid your dues according to whatever contempt they nailed you with.
Another thing that would be ridiculous, if you have a driver's license, you get pulled over for a traffic ticket, you go into court to argue it, or whatever you're going to do, ask them if they have any evidence that this applies to me. Well, yeah, the evidence is, number one, you got the driver's license. Number two, you're here in court.
Right.
You answered the summons.
Right.
Only the dead can be summoned. Okay? So, you're acknowledging your civil death by showing up. And, you know, you even have to sign in the court, I believe, as I recall. Let them know you're there. And then they got the evidence. They got everything they need. They got the body. And they're going to administrate you accordingly to offset the congressional bankruptcy through 28 United States Code Section 453, which is tied in through the rest of the treaties to the other so-called countries under that Atlantic Charter. It's all roads leading to Rome.
Right. That's it. And if you go to Black's Law Dictionary, I thought I'd bring in a definition there. The word meritagium means the portion which is given with a daughter in marriage, also the power which the lord or guardian in chivalry had of disposing of his infant ward in matrimony. That's the action of guarding or marriage license and renting property from the state or the Lord God. And it's absolutely profound once you grab that. Can they find, we have links to Black's in at Choose Your Side, right? I believe so.
Yeah.
ChooseYourSide.org. And it should be.
Should have. If not, we'll probably need to get them up.
Yeah, and if not, come on Skype.
We keep building it. The definitions page is good. It has a lot of the definitions out of Black's Law and etymology that we use a lot.
Yeah, they're constantly updating it. I've noticed that Andy works really hard at updating it, and I've noticed that you do too. So if it's not there yet, it'll be there. Again, you know, we transport a lot of files on Skype. You know, whatever you want to study at any given time, it doesn't have to be just this. It can be a foundations. It can be if you want to learn more about psychology. I've got 90,000 ebooks or electronic versions of books now. And, you know, whatever you need, add me on Skype, T Pepperman, and we'll get you what you need. Latin dictionary, Latin etymology dictionaries, Greek etymology, English etymology, whatever's necessary to get you going forward, whatever you need.
Yeah, and you'll see the definition there for confederacy. I think I do have the truncated version up there. Maybe we should expand the full version so you can see at the end. It says, see federal government.
Yep.
Forgotten about that as I was making the not-so-viral video, Attorneys of the Confederacy.
Right. Now, for all of our listeners out there, we're going to hammer it home on marriages, because when you're contracting with the state, when you're filing the habeas corpuses, if you go to, and it says this again in the Constitutional Theory, Article 1, Section 9, Clauses 1 and 2. Now, habendum, from Black's Law Dictionary, 1891, in conveyancing, the clause usually following the granting part of the premises of a deed, which defines the extent of the ownership in the thing granted to be held and enjoyed by a grantee. Now, when you go down to habendum et tenendum, okay, you have all heard this. When you enter into that marriage contract under the state, it's actually the Latin for to have and to hold. In old conveyancing, to have and to hold formal words in deeds of land from a very early period. Now, that female is being conveyed to you to rent, but only to have and to hold. You're not possessing the estate. You're not owning the estate. She's only a tenant under their house that's being rented to you in a fiefdom during the time that you're lawfully or legally married. Now, for forever, Congress, Dianne Feinstein, Barbara Boxer, Johnny Cornyn, oh blah blah, they're up there saying, well, the male is sexist. He's preying on you. He does all sorts of things to you. The state is renting human beings through licensing. It is a pimp. That means that females are viewed as prostitutes, property to convey over to the male. And the male has no idea.
The pimp.
Right, the state is the pimp. And you have no idea. I mean, you guys enter, you hear those words, to have and to hold, to death do you part. Well, that's actually a bad thing. It's conveying property. And it's the state saying that they're the owner of that property. And they've been saying that since the Coronation Charter. Since the king came
also
in.
Also known as the Charter of Liberties.
Absolutely, and it was redone again with William Penn. He did the same thing. He reiterated the Charter of Liberties with the, quote, Charter of Liberties. And both of them, you need to compare them because it's sick. It's sick and disgusting because the first one says, well, you know, as the king, we're going to hold on to all these females' properties and estates for you just in case any of the men die. Well, then what happened? Well, they killed off all the men.
Yeah, by sending them to war.
Yes. And among other things.
You know, in case you men die, here's your sword and your shield. Good luck.
Yep.
You got to go fight for the king's land over there.
And it's been like that forever until now. In this process, the female's not owned. She's possessed.
And right now, we're at this
truth.
Apex.
Right.
The attorneys, okay, some people call them bankers, but bankers are just, They're ones that work at law firms that people call banks, run by a bunch of attorneys. But essentially, the lawmaker attorneys would love nothing more than to get more wars or another war or the big war going to distract everybody.
Absolutely. That's the whole point of what they're doing, is to kill off the male. Of course, they need to remove the firstborn son. Why? Well, they like to prey on females and children. That's their function. That's what the business is.
So,
are you going to read the definition of confederacy?
Well, let's see here. I suppose We'll go over it one more time here, just to hammer this home. And remember the Articles of Confederation that were written in 1777, agreed upon in 1781, written by the same people that wrote the Constitution, in other words, Congress. And the patriots out there are going to tell you, well, it was replaced with the Constitution. Yeah, well, like we've evidenced that throughout time, all these things just keep building upon one another. And yeah, they replaced it. They moved the Articles of Confederation over so they could make room for the Constitution to go next to it. That's all it was.
Right, and all of those are Articles of Incorporation.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Maybe we can spend some more time on it, but definition of Confederacy out of blacks first. In criminal law, the association or banding together of two or more persons for the purpose of committing an act or furthering an enterprise which is forbidden by law, or which through lawful in itself becomes unlawful when made the object of the Confederacy. Conspiracy is a more technical term for this offense. The act of two or more who combine together to do any damage or injury to another, or to do any unlawful act. In equity pleading, an improper combination alleged to have been entered into between the defendants to a bill in equity. In international law, a league, okay, a league, L-E-A-G-U-E, and we'll go back to that definition as well, or agreement between two or more independent states whereby they unite for their mutual welfare and the furtherance of their common aims. The term may apply to a union so formed for a temporary or limited purpose, as in the case of an offense and a defense, offensive and defensive alliance, but is also more commonly used to denote that species of political connection between two or more independent states by which a central government is created, invested with certain powers of sovereignty, mostly external, and acting upon the several component states as its units. Okay? Now, I'm going to go over to the top of the page. However, retain their sovereign powers for domestic purposes and some others. See federal government.
Now that sums it up all in a nutshell. Now the league, of course, is a synonym for Confederacy. Now in 1924, they came in with the League of Nations Covenant, which was replaced by the 1945 United Nations Charter. All of these things have that central form of government. And of course, it's defined right there in Black's Law Dictionary 1891, see federal government. The Russian Federation is part of the Confederacy. Greece, France, Germany, Afghanistan, Iraq, India, Australia, they're all in league with each other. They're all in the Confederacy with one central form of government since 1941 Atlantic Charter. And before, they were contracted with each other through treaty agreements, through charterability. But it was all solidified in 1941 under the Atlantic Charter. There's not my government and your government, or my culture and your culture. Culture indoctrination, religious indoctrination, language indoctrination is a means of pitting you against each other. It's all owned by the same government force. The same exact government.
By patronizing whatever government you're told to patronize in your locality, all roads lead to Rome. You're acknowledging the fact that you're a willful, compliant plebeian slash citizen and are there at the behest of these attorneys to offset congressional bankruptcy as a hypothecated person, and this is the global banking schematic.
And that is Babylonian theory. That's Babel. When you patronize a culture, a language, a form of government under the same central government, that's Babel. They own Babel. Now, when you allow yourself to be pit up against each other, that allows Babel to continue. Now, in Revelation, what does it say? When you stop, you and I, at one time, we're all the whores of Babel when we're buying into it, because we're fornicating with Congress. We're saying it's our father. We're married to it. When you stop patronizing that thing, it says right in Revelation, Revelation 18, Babel falls. There's no more Babel.
Yeah, they need your compliance. They need your consent. They need your estates that you're given over willingly when you register these things. Sign your baby up there on the birth certificate to be a pledged asset for the corporation. They got your consent, and they say, thank you very much. We'll go on being your representative, and we'll be using you to offset congressional bankruptcy so we can have more and you can have less.
Great.
And that means less of their attorney money, less of your rights, and you all see how bad it's getting these days. It's because they're so bankrupt and depraved.
And that's what it's all about. That's what everyone has been living under. When you're adhering to these last names, to these cultural indoctrinations, to the language indoctrination, and playing into Babylonian theory, you're living as a fiction. That's depravity. You don't know thyself. You're claiming to be a cartoon, a fiction, a description. And that's how you're taken. That's nomenclature. Nom means law. En is a word to give. Clature means a grasping motion. So if somebody's telling, for example, in the Garden of Eden, that's the doctrine of abiogenesis, away from life, mind, and soul. So Adam was given the power to name all things, nomenclature. Now, who gives him that power? Because an authority has to be giving them that power, right? It's telling Adam, okay, it's okay for you to name all things. It's giving you a license. A patriarch is giving Adam a license to facilitate nomenclature.
And under that license, he has certain obligations, like to register or report that naming so they can keep track of it in their...
Title VII, agricultural laws.
Yeah, and it basically boils down to the money bag for the exchequer.
It does. Because that's what it is. It's the thesaurus itself. That's where the gold is.
Yeah, all the words that we use, like man, for example. Everyone say, I'm a free man on the land. Well,
gender.
Exchequer is just saying, okay, good for you. Here's some more goodies here for my purse.
Yeah, you want some rights to go with those French fries? They have a patent on that word. That's what letters patent are. Every word has a patent on it because it's created by nomenclature. To name all things down to their smallest iota, which is also the doctrine of a Thomas. And if you study deeper into the doctrine of a Thomas, you find out what? Well, there was a philosopher, quote philosopher, called Democritus. He was a laughing philosopher who came up with the doctrine of the Thomas. So again, you have a concept, Democritus, offering you the doctrine of the Thomas, to name all things down to their smallest iota. And that's what it's all about, names. Not just, you know, giving them your birth certificate or whatever else, dancing around, playing all of this crap. If you're acting as the fiction, you're acting as the fiction. It doesn't matter what you say. I'm not that thing. I'm not that thing. I'm not that thing. It's not just what you say. It's what you do. And so if you're acting as the fiction, you're the fiction. It doesn't matter what you say.
If you're opening that mail, it's got that patented last name on it, then just more evidence for them building their case against you.
Right.
I mean, whether it be whatever your last name is. Proper name is only the first and middle name. That's the proper name. That's all I use. That's all I use anymore. Okay, right. I object when people call me Mr. or any other title they want to attach to my proper name or endearment. I don't like titles. Although I guess I let people slide with it because people are so programmed to be politically correct and say thanks, things like thank you, sir.
Right.
I don't really like that, but I just kind of consider it an endearment and write it off.
Right.
Unless it's an attorney, then I'm going to correct that buzzard.
Right. Because that's part of nomenclature. Junior, senior, you know, taking up titles separates you from the garment. It's casting lots. Crucifixion.
From the Etymology Dictionary, gender, from circa 1300. Kind, sort, class, from Old French gender. 12th century, modern French genre, G-E-N-R-E. From stem of Latin, genus, genitive, generis, race, stock, family, kind, rank, order, species, also male or female, sex, see genus, and used to translate Aristotle's Greek grammatical term genos. The grammatical sense is attested in English from the late 14th century, the male or female sense from the early 15th century. A sex took on erotic qualities in the 20th century. Oh, of course it did.
Indoctrination. It's part of the educational program.
Edward Bernays came along and got all those Beatles groupies to wear them short skirts and such. Gender came to be the common word used for sex of a human being, often in feminist writing, with reference to social attributes as much as biological qualities. This sense first attested 1963. Gender bender is first attested 1980. With reference to pop star David Bowie, and even though it doesn't say it here, then later with the robot Bender in Futurama.
Right.
I was just driving that home from that earlier concept. See, gender is the verb. Now, the first definition I got through there is a noun. The verb means to bring forth, late 14th century from Old French, gendrer, from Latin, generar, to engender. See generation, related, gendered, gendering.
So gender stems from the word genus, a new species of human being, a description. It's not a relative state. It's another concept sold to you by a law merchant. And with that, you get to buy the rights and benefits that come with that race, stock, family, kind, rank, order, species. Every time you claim feminist rights or masculine rights, those are stocks. Race, stock, family, kind, rank, order, species. You're taking up the title that you're something different than the rest of humanity, or the rest of the garment. And at that point in time, you're separated, which allows the 8 stages of genocide, classification, You know, and that's something that everybody needs to divest themselves of. Stop calling yourself different than I am. Stop calling yourself something different than I am. That's exactly what Jesus said. You are not different than I am. You are a state of being, a sovereign state, as long as you're upholding the public law. A foreign state is defined by one acting under acts of commerce and private acts. 28 U.S.C. subsection 1603. Now, did you want to go through some headlines? Or I'm just kind of taking it easy tonight. I wanted to
Whatever you want to do. I'm just here to be of any assistance I can be.
Yeah.
Now, we had some technical difficulties at the beginning there where you were reading that story on the mayor that got busted. I thought that was pretty cute.
Oh, it was. It was funny. Do you
got
have
sentence,
that?
Got sentence. Yeah, I got it up here.
Okay, good, because I was looking up another definition.
Let's see. D.S. Widow Pines Blogspot. I'm not sure what that is. But anyways, Trenton mayor sentenced to prison on extortion, bribery, and fraud charges. That's Mayor Tony F. Mack has been sentenced to 58 months in prison.
Wah, wah, wah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. After being convicted at trial in February on all six federal extortion, bribery, and mail and wire fraud charges against him. Let's see here. Mack's brother, Ralphiel Mack, who was also convicted on three of the charges but found not guilty on three mail fraud and wire fraud counts, was sentenced to 30 months in prison. So I guess bird monsters of a feather run amok together.
Well, hopefully they'll get Sheriff Mack, too. That's what I've been waiting for.
Yeah.
You need that other
constitutional sheriffs. God, they're now just pitching the constitutional sheriffs left and right. Oh, you know, all roads lead to Rome. You know, constitutional sheriff just means that he's acting under that letter of mark and reprisal. Article 1, let's see, that Section 8, Clause 11, I believe. Okay. So, in the United States Constitution, anyways. And the Commerce Clause. So, that sheriff is allowed to allow all this human trafficking to go on through that Commerce Clause. Isn't it good to have a constitutional sheriff? The Macks were charged in connection with the scheme to accept $119,000 in bribes in exchange for Mayor Mack's official actions and influence in assisting cooperating witnesses in the development of an automated parking garage on city-owned land. City. See, here they say a city, a fiction, can own land. Isn't the attorney world so nice where federal government... the fiction owns land
only by their consent. If a citizen is claiming to be a citizen, they're saying they live there, which allows that thing to be relative. And the citizens have to stop patronizing that thing, and it goes away. The citizens are the ones that are claiming to live there in that space, national space, national or commercial space, Title 51. USC.
Tony F. Mack, 48, and Ralph E.L. Mack, 41, both of Trenton, originally were charged by complaint on September 10th, 2012, with one count of conspiracy to obstruct commerce by extortion under color of official right related to the $119,000 extortion scheme. Also charged at the time was Joseph A. Gregoriana, 64, of Ewing, New Jersey. An indictment returned in December 2012 added charges against all three defendants. Georgiana pleaded guilty on December 13, 2013 to one count of conspiring with the Macks and others to obstruct interstate commerce by extorting individuals under color of official right. In addition to a separate extortion scheme, a narcotics charge, and illegal weapons possession, all charges unrelated to Max. Mayor Mack was convicted of the six counts charged in the indictment. Conspiracy to obstruct and affect interstate commerce by extortion under color of official right. Attempted obstruction of commerce by extortion under the color of official right. Accepting and agreeing to accept bribes. Two counts of wire fraud, mail fraud. Raphael Mack was convicted on the same first three counts and found guilty on the mail and wire fraud charges. The jury members deliberated for 7 hours before returning the verdicts. According to documents filed in this case and the evidence presented at trial, Tony Mack, Giorgiani, and Raphael Mack conspired to accept approximately $119,000 in cash and other valuables, of which $54,000 was accepted and another $65,000 that the defendants planned to accept from two cooperating witnesses, CW1 and CW2. Oh, this goes on and this on. But basically, you just see that these are just typical. These are just typical politicians. Come on.
Right.
They're just getting nailed now.
He was doing his job. It said he was extorting through his official right. It says he was being a mayor, according to his definition, and now that's a criminal act. Which it's amazing to see that they're falling down and being charged for those things. Now I wanted to read the definition out of Black's 8th edition, 2004, of Black Acre. Black Acre is a fictitious tract of land used in legal discourse, especially law school hypotheticals, to discuss real property issues. When another tract of land is needed in a hypothetical, it is often termed White Acre. Quote, Black Acre is the most celebrated tract of land in the world of law. Black Acre is wholly mythical, yet totally real. It is a concept living in the realm of the mind and doubly valuable since much of the law of property has the same type of reality. That's what you are, folks, when you are hypothecated. You are called real property. Your children are called issues, as defined under the definition of real law. The letter A in Black's Law Dictionary, 8th edition. A hypothetical person. Such as a deed's Black Acre. 2, meaning from, by, in, on, of, or at. 3, with. 4, of, at, to, for, in, or with. 5, regarding securities. A letter used in a newspaper stock transaction table to indicate the cash was paid during the year in addition to regular dividends. 6, securities. A letter used in a newspaper mutual fund transaction table to indicate a yield that may include capital gains and losses, as well as current interest. 7, securities. A letter used in a newspaper corporate earnings report to identify the American Stock Exchange as the primary market of a firm's common stock. Remember, go back to the definition etymology of gender. 8, securities. An above average grade given to a debt obligation by a ratings agency. The grades as ranked by Standard & Poor's range from AAA, the highest, down to CCC. The equivalent standards from Moody's are AAA with a capital A, double A, capital A, little a, capital A, little a, capital B, little a, and so on down to C. 9, marine insurance. A rating assigned in Lloyd's Register of Shipping to ships considered to be in first class condition. 10, abbreviated adversus. 11, historical. A scarlet letter worn as punishment by a person convicted of adultery. 12, in Roman law, an abbreviation for absolvo written on wooden tablets by criminal court judges to indicate a vote for acquittal. 13, Roman law, an abbreviation for antiquo, quote, for the old law, end quote, written on wooden tablets by the participants in a popular assembly to indicate a vote against a proposed bill. Now, again, I think that we've got various copies of Black's on chooseyourside.org and TammyPepperman.org. Again, if you need a copy, get with me, T. Pepperman, on Skype, and I can give you a copy. I can't send it through email because it's too large. Most often, when our students start, a lot of them are not aware of how many files they're going to get. And to give you an example, when I was in Illinois sharing my files, it took, about 34 gigabytes to give you basically what you need to just go off and study without having to study in the classrooms. So if you've got, say 50 gigabytes altogether, we'll have a lot of fun together. I really enjoy learning. I like questions. So, if you're sitting in the class and you're wondering why everything's so slow sometimes, start a conversation. That's how things work in Skype. It's just a very, very casual class type setting. It's not like, with any rules or censorship. I will kick you out if you're trying to commingle processes or advertise for Donna Ray or others, Gene Keating or whatever, but that's just common sense.
Yeah, we had Gene Keating in there for a while, too. We had to kick him out.
Right, as well as Donna Ray. They were promoting their processes, and it was just such a sad thing. And they do the same thing on YouTube. They try to get away with it. What about this? Have you heard about blah, blah, blah? And they'll do a show link. Hello, we know your agents. It's irritating. But, when you post that kind of thing, you're evidencing who you are and evidencing, of course, that you're delivering them up. And, of course, in Matthew, it says that you receive the greater damnation in the end for your accountability. So you might want to rethink what you're doing.
So why don't we take a moment here and share with everybody what we can about what's going on with the case. I know it's limited as far as what we can really tell you, but we can tell you things are going good.
Really good.
It's never as quick as you'd like it to be with these attorneys. I mean, that's a big part of their game is to wait you out, but the wheels are turning.
Right, and the waiting's over. Of course, we had to go through the lines of insurance and everything else, and the insurance came back and said, okay, they're not covered for acts of war, civil war risks, whatever. We had to go through that. We had to make sure and notify everybody. Did you know that your franchise is doing this? You're fully aware that you're promoting civil war and civil war risk and war, right? Because Coverhold doesn't cover those types of activity.
And we evidenced that in Rocco's situation, he's only being held as a prisoner of war.
Right.
They have nothing else besides the guns and the bars,
right,
to hold them for.
Right, and they're changing their minds. It just took a lot to get them to change their mind because they've never been held accountable for these things.
They're like Scooby.
Yeah, right. And that's what Jesus said. It says, look, I'm going to come like a thief in the night. Well, yeah, you pick up Rocco, and in all actuality, he's Jesus. You're trying to hold Jesus or John in your holding corporation. That's not a good idea. And finally, of course, we got to the pass the insurance. The insurance declined to cover them, yada, yada. So now we're at the, and we've been talking about this a lot, the foreclosure process. We're not just doing Rocco's case. We're doing many, many, many The latest today was, you know, one of the states and several counties of various states have 14 days left. Some have 24 hours left, yada, yada. It doesn't matter. They had all of this time to respond, to pay the amounts owed. You know, each one's at a different phase or stage or whatever. We just had to go through all of the red tape to get to this point in time. And, you know, like you said, yesterday one state and what, three counties had 24 hours left and their time was up. So then, of course, the liens go down. Now we're dealing with somebody else. It has 14 days. We just started somebody else in Florida. And these things, you know, we're all game if you want to play with us. And like I said earlier in the show, we've simplified. So if you want to elect me as governor, it makes things a lot easier on your house, because then I just go ahead and do what needs to be done. You make sure that your house is standing. First of all, F&E docs your fee schedule and your ordinance of the states. Now, you can lay down another's fee schedule as long as it's recorded and it's in line with your fee schedule. Make sure it says the same thing that you want to say. Now, the reason for that is that I don't get paid. I don't get paid as a clerk. I don't get paid as a governor. None of us take any of those assets. Those are yours. They belong to your house. And that's why your house has to be standing. And if you elect me as your governor, I'm under your house. I'm surrounded by your house rules. As long as your rules fit my rules, which is the truth, then we're good to go. You have to be adhering to the public law. You cannot be adhering to acts of commerce and private acts. Otherwise, you are a foreign state. You don't have any sovereignty, and your house is not built on stone. It's built on sand or built with sticks. And as everybody knows, the wolf blows that one down. But the wheels turn slowly until now. And now is when we're seeing everything come to fruition. And, you know, as I said, this week I was able to relax several times and didn't even realize it until after I relaxed. And I haven't rested in years and years, thankfully, because of our law enforcement, because of what is happening. And it surprised me. I made a bunch of cheese and yogurt and all sorts of stuff this week, and then realized afterwards that I actually had time to do those things.
Yes.
It was nice.
Yeah, I bet. Well, what else can we share about the case? I mean, I guess obviously, you know, later down the road, once we get past this phase, we'll be able to teach this insurance aspect.
Absolutely.
Really kind of been kind of...
Well, I'm not
state
gonna put
security
in,
for the time being, but
right, especially for the houses. I'm not going to share internal information because it is state security regarding those other houses. And you know, Jesus taught one thing that was so profound. First of all, he said, don't speak your intent. That's absolutely stupid to speak your intent, Matthew 6. Second, he taught, of course, let the dead bury their own dead. If you don't want to come this way, I am not going to pitch you some snake oil. I'm not going to advertise to you to come this way. I'm not going to drag you this way. I'm not going to pull you this way. It's all up to you. Take up your cross and follow me is what Jesus actually said. So if you are waiting for a reward, you're not going to get it, because I'm never going to promise you a reward for coming this way. And as soon as all of these things come to fruition, I'm out of here, because I am not going to tell you what the other houses got. I'm not going to tell you what happened, because Jesus said not to, because that makes you Judas. That makes you Lucifer. And I'm sure as heck not going to offer you any kind of a gimmick, and that's not in the rules. It has to be with free will.
So we're hopeful we'll see Rocco here soon. I mean, every day that they keep holding him is racking up some serious change on their behalf, so it's not like we need them to rack up much more, and we're looking forward to getting them back on the shows here and sharing the experience. But he's not going to be bailed out or released, okay? He's going to be discharged. And so it's the game's afoot. The game's well afoot. We're deep into it. And really, it's about, I think that's about as much as we can share at this point. Say your prayers out there for Rocco. And again, we were, I don't know if we said it, but we were notified by our deputy that he's doing okay, so.
Yep, Wednesday.
He's not harmed. Yeah, Wednesday, our deputy came and said that checked out to be okay. Holding him in a pretrial facility in Kenosha, Wisconsin, although there's no trial set, so it's interesting there.
No, they were trying to find any and all loopholes, and as everybody sees, he's not charged with the crime. He's not being held. He hasn't been taken to hearing, and that is because they couldn't find any loopholes, and their time is out now. You know, we were told other things today, but again, we're not going to share those until next week, probably. Everything is great. And like I said, you know, I'm pretty sure that, you know, leaving the farm is done soon because of the rules of the game. Jesus said, you know, we're not supposed to purchase anybody. We're not supposed to sell lip service or anything else. If others don't want to come this way, then that's their choice. That's their free will. And, you know, if you have to be rewarded to be human, you're not human. We do this because of humanity. That's why we're here. That's why Rocco's where he is. And he's done what he's done. Because he's human. And those are the rules. Be human. And if you're not, then you require financial remuneration or toys or gifts or the promise of something. And Jesus said, we're not going to do that. That's against the rules. And I've gone this far in all of my walk, and it's been a long and arduous journey. I am not, absolutely not, going to bend or break those rules at this point in the game.
All right, we've got 15 minutes here, what would you like to use for a game plan there? You got another story you started reading. I think I cut you off earlier.
Yeah, ICC's Steinberg got 3.5 years in prison for insider trading.
Ooh, goody.
So they're falling on each other. Ratifying agencies, yeah. Michael Steinberg, a portfolio manager at Stephen A. Cohen's SEC Capital Advisors hedge fund, was sentenced on Friday to 3.5 years in prison for insider trading. The sentence was imposed by U.S. District Judge Richard Sullivan in Manhattan 5 months after a federal jury convicted Steinberg on securities fraud and conspiracy charges in a case stemming from a broad crackdown on insider trading on Wall Street. Steinberg's lawyers had asked for no more than 2 years in prison, while prosecution had argued for up to 6.5 years. Sullivan also ordered Steinberg to pay 2 million FRNs fine and forfeit $365,142 in FRNs, a sum the government says Steinberg and an SEC analyst were paid from illegal trading profits. Dozens of family members and friends attended the sentencing and sent letters to the judge. The letter, Sullivan said, described Steinberg in a positive light that set him apart from other defendants he had sentenced. Quote, if it were only based on the character of this man, it would be easy, because I do think this is a good man, end quote, he said, but I have to consider the crime here. Prosecutors accused Steinberg of trading on illegal tips about Dell Incorporated and NVIDIA Corporation passed to him by SEC analysts who admitted to swapping confidential information among a group of analysts at other hedge funds. Steinberg's trading resulted in illegal profits of 1.82 million FRNs, prosecutors said. Steinberg, 42, is one of eight current or former SAC Capital employees to be convicted on insider trading charges. It's interesting that, you know, that they haven't learned yet. They're still sticking around and trying to see if they can eke out all those little FRNs still. But, you know, they're rolling on each other, so.
Yeah. And can happen to a bunch of more swell group of folks. I mean, you know, I mean, for example, I mean, here's just take a look at some headlines. Here's some of the things that you'll get if you choose door number one to patronize that thing called government. In Kentucky, Kentucky takes DEA to court over illegal hemp seed seizure. Now, this is what the law merchants will do. They're going to argue that they have rights over stuff that comes out of the ground. You give it to them by patronizing and, you know, buying into their concepts, their constitutions, and the whole ball of wax. FCC, of course, they propose new fast lanes. Going to shut down this net neutrality with their net neutrality bills and such. Let's see. Okay. DEA agent accused of assaulting woman with M. I don't know what the headline means. 16 during synthetic drug raid. The Drug Enforcement Agency in coordination with Customs Border Protection began a nationwide synthetic drug takedown called Project Synergy, Phase 2, serving 200 search warrants in 29 states across the country on Wednesday. Now, so that's more about commercial crimes, telling you what you can do and what you can't do, and all this good stuff. Oligarchs join forces, lying, cheating, and stealing together. Of course they do. Their league, their confederacy. This is us. This is your government. Let's see. Feds push for big data. Far from cracking down on the monitoring of consumer information, the Obama administration has sought to leverage the power of big data, sometimes running afoul of privacy advocates.
Yeah, that's another way of pitting humanity against itself and each other. Again, you don't have any privacy. When you fill out those applications, registrations, Delphi surveys, census surveys, all of these things, when you're sharing your information on Facebook, I'm so bored, pictures of your children, you don't have any privacy. And privacy, again, is a concept, so they can sell you that concept by putting you into fear of yourselves and each other. That's another patented product. They're cashing in on that. That's where the gold is.
Yeah, there you go. And all these patents now that they hold so many of, now that's come to light lately, how these corporations just have patent after patent after patent. And patents, of, as we've talked about in the past, and again, we'll say it again, and they're unlawful on their face. Under the public law, all these patents go away. All the borders go away. Human beings are going to be free to be human beings as long as they don't harm another human being. All right? And we're going to hold those that do accountable equally. That means if your name is Nancy Pelosi or your name is Joe Blow, you're held accountable in the same manner, to the same standards, not oligarchs get a slap on the wrist and...
or the one with
citizen,
the money.
Citizen goes to jail for life because of marijuana. You know.
Or if you have more money, you can get out of it. It doesn't work that way here. And it will never, ever be the same again.
And just to put this in this perspective, the wars that the attorneys create, okay, because I take it one step beyond the all wars are bankers' wars, because in reality, it's all wars are attorney wars. That's the real truth of it. Not bankers. Bankers are just people that work for law firms called banks. So, anyways, all wars are attorney wars. But 90% of all deaths in wars are civilians. 90%. Let that sink in for a minute.
Yeah, you don't have any attorneys going to fight for your country, do you?
No, I haven't seen attorneys go to boot camp and all that.
Nope. And that's something that you'll never see. They love that citizen.
I don't, somebody's asked me about America Spring. I don't know what happened to America Spring today.
I don't cover that. It's another constitutional theory. If you're going to go
march
and ask Congress to please stop hurting us, please stop hurting us, petitioning Congress, marching on you know, Washington, D.C., it's the same thing as patronizing them.
Yes.
You're asking them to please stop harming you. Stop doing
Congress
that.
Congress is just going to say, okay, thanks for your consent. We're going to keep harming you.
Right. How about we? How about just for you today, I offer you an affirmative action program, you know, because you guys are all racist and stuff, right? So we'll pocket all that money because you're really not racist, but we'll tell you you are through the media.
It's like, it's kind of like asking Congress to stop being Congress.
All right, so 12 USC, or U.S. Code, 12 is the banking aspect of U.S. Code. If you go to Title 12, United States Code, under the Emergency Banking Act, the attorney got their attorney oath, which is why we're here. You, plebeian, are being used to discharge congressional bankruptcy under the 1933 Emergency Banking Act. Congress declared bankruptcy in 1933. Now these banks, the attorney oath, 12 U.S.C. subsection 73, the oath. Each director, when appointed or elected, shall take an oath that he will, so far as the duty devolves on him, diligently and honestly administer the affairs of such association, and will not knowingly violate or willingly permit to be violated any of the provisions of Title 62 of the revised statutes, and that he is the owner in good faith and in his own right of the number of shares of stock required by Title 62 of the revised statutes subscribed by him or standing in his name on the books of the association, and that the same is not hypothecated or in any way pledged as security for any loan or debt. The oath shall be taken before a notary public, properly authorized and commissioned by the state in which he resides, or before any other officer having an official seal and authorized by the state to administer oaths, except that the oath shall not be taken before any such notary public or other officer who is an officer of the director's bank. The oath, subscribed by the director making it and certified by the notary public or other officer before whom it is taken, shall be immediately transmitted to the comptroller of the currency and shall be filed and preserved in his office for a period of 10 years. So you're wondering what these attorneys are. They are bankers. That's all they are. Now you go to 28 U.S.C. 453. And, of course, you're going to find the judicial oath. Let me go grab that while we're here. Oaths of justices and judges, 28 U.S.C., of course, is the Judiciary Act, stemming from the 1789 Judiciary Act, establishing those banks. 28 U.S.C., subsection 453, oaths of justices and judges. Each justice or judge of the United States shall take the following oath or affirmation before performing the duties of his office. I, blah, 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 do solemnly swear or affirm that I will administer justice without respect to persons and do respect to persons, which means seeing them in another way. Respect to persons and do equal right to the poor and to the rich. And that I will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform all the duties incumbent upon me as blah blah under the Constitution and laws of the United States. So help me God.
These attorneys are sick.
Absolutely. And this goes right in line with Article 12 of the Articles of Confederation. The United States is charged and pledged to discharge congressional bankruptcy. And that's why we're here, folks. This has been the public law. And I think we'll close out here.
We have 5 minutes left.
Oh, okay. 5 minutes left.
It's 5 till.
Oh, sorry about that. I thought that we were almost done.
All right, I've got another story here at newsinfo.inquire.net. Manila government official charged with bribe, graft rap under probe. The charge of bribery has been recommended for filing in court against Manila City building official Juan Cupicino. After he was arrested by the police on Tuesday afternoon for allegedly accepting a $50,000 bribe from an architect and construction firm representative. I'm not sure what $50,000 amounts to in U.S. dollars, but pesos.
Pesetos. I think they're pesetos at that point, and peseto means silver.
It's probably quite a lot, though. Right. Anyways, it doesn't matter if it's a dollar or $50,000. I mean, they're in these positions and
doing these things.
Financial crimes are financial crimes, and that's their elected form of government. So financial crimes, commercial crimes applies to them.
Absolutely. And this is a government official taking money from a contractor, construction company, developer, in order to facilitate national security. So now that's a crime to do that. And we've been seeing this over and over again. And these agencies, these officers, these officials, these politicians, they're not hearing. You are being cannibalized for doing what was prior your job. And the best thing you could do is take an offensive stance or a defensive stance and stop doing what you're doing because it's unlawful. And of course, as you see here, they are being held accountable swiftly.
Yeah, good. Another surety in there. Get on in there, a little surety.
Absolutely.
It's worldwide. No attorney will be turned down for a surety. Anybody that wants the contract is welcome to come in there and take their position in Northern Holding Corporation.
Absolutely.
And be the thing that offsets congressional bankruptcy, because it was never lawful on its face back in 1929 when they threw the human beings into the holding corporations in the first place. And that's basically the form of our enslavement, the way it looks, by construct since 1929 anyways.
Right. So are you going to take us out with a song? I've got, of course, Pink Floyd queued up and stuff, but you frown on those things. What are you interested in hearing?
Well, let's see. I've been on a Weird Al Yankovic kick lately, but I guess we'll say that for next time. I don't think we have any Weird Al Yankovic.
I do. I think I've only got the beer song or something like that, but let's see here.
I just love Smells Like Nirvana and I Lost in Jeopardy. Those are a couple old ones, but Weird Al has a good sense of humor, so you've got to have a sense of humor every once in a while. How about Forrest Gump?
Forrest Gump, all right.
Yeah, that's a good upbeat song. Got to do something upbeat here.
All right, let me go find it here. I just loaded it up.
So tune in to our various shows and YouTube channels for all the latest breaking attorney surety roundup headline. Get them in their news.
Don't miss the
as we return the world to the public law.
Absolutely. Be well, everybody. Love you.